Welcome to the Roadhogs Radio Network, brought to you by theroadhogs.com and Roadhogs Motorcycle Magazine. Let's get the show started. Here's your host.
Everybody, what's going on? It's Wednesday evening, April 15th, so it's tax day here in the United States of America. Hopefully Uncle Sam didn't get you too bad on your taxes and you're actually going to get a refund. It's the dreaded day every year. So anyway, welcome to the show tonight. It's Classic Chrome on the Roadhogs Radio Network. Glad you could join us. We look forward to every week on the show, and it's a lot of fun to do the show. This week, we have a great program lined up for you, as always. I got some great guests with me tonight. I really appreciate them taking the time out of their schedules. I'd like to give a quick thank you to the production crew that I've got working with me that makes all this possible. Wouldn't be able to be done without them. So thanks to the guys, and let's get into the show tonight. So I'd like to first of all congratulate Revival Cycles over the weekend in Austin, Texas. Revival Cycles held the hand-built motorcycle show, which we had Alan Stolberg on a few weeks ago to talk about the show. It's the second annual, and it's growing by the thousands every year. I believe this year they had over 100 invited builders from all over the world. Some amazing bikes were on display, and it was a lot of fun. The figures I heard were somewhere in the 18 to 20,000 people range that came over 3 days to see it. So great job, guys. I want to congratulate you all, and we look forward to next year. Now, if you want to find out more information about the Handbuilt Show or Revival Cycles, go to thehandbuiltmotorcycleshow.com. All right, so tonight, the program is brought to you in part by the Antique Motorcycle Club of America, Cycle Motors Motorcycle Museum, Wheels Through Time Transportation Museum, Retro Cycle, Carson Classic Motors, Georgia Motorcycle History, the first 60 years, 1899 to 1959, the Rocky Mountain Motorcycle Museum, and last but not least, one of our newest sponsors, The Race of the Century, presented by Motorcycle Cannonball. Now, if you or your business are interested in becoming sponsors of the program, please give us a shout at classicchromeradio@gmail.com, and we'll hook you up with an advertising media package here for you and see if we can't help promote your product or company. So, once again, that's classicchromeradio@gmail.com. Some announcements for you. Wheels for Time is open for the 2015 season. Museum hours are 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. from Thursday to Monday. Museum is closed on Tuesdays and Wednesdays. Admission prices are $12 for adults, $10 for seniors 65 and over, and $6 for children. Now, don't forget, Wheels for Time is offering two special opportunities to win an antique motorcycle in 2015. The annual museum raffle will be held in November of 2015, with the final prize being a 1939 Harley-Davidson knucklehead bobber built with original parts right there in the Wheels Through Time Restoration Shop. This year, the museum will also be holding the Mega Raffle, where one lucky individual will walk away with the ultimate antique motorcycle, and that's a 1939 Crocker Hemihead Twin. This Crocker is the eighth hand-built engine produced in Al Crocker's California-based motorcycle company, earliest running example in existence. The discovery of this engine was featured in the first season of the hit television show What's in the Barn on the Velocity Network. Now, find out more information about both raffles and museum hours and purchase your tickets for both raffles by visiting the museum website at wheelsthroughtime.com. Tonight's program, we are talking with the AMCA Smoky Mountain chapter. With me, I've got some great guests. So tonight we are focusing on the AMCA. One of the upcoming announcements I got for you is to come on out to the Barber Motorsports Museum in Birmingham, Alabama, on April 16th, which is tomorrow evening, and attend the very first meeting of the AMCA Smoky Mountain chapter. More information can be found by visiting the AMCA Smoky Mountain Facebook page by searching for Smoky Mountain AMCA chapter on Facebook, and you'll find out more this evening when we talk with the folks from Smoky Mountain chapter. contending with the AMCA upcoming events. On April 24th and 25th, the AMCA Perkaman Chapter National Meet will be taking place at the Ole Fairgrounds in Ole, Pennsylvania. Coming out to the third national meet for the club, and check out the massive swap meet and bike show. More information available at antiquemotorcycle.org. And finally, for the month of April, from April 30th to May 2nd, the AMCA Cherokee Chapter is going to be putting on a massive display of antique motorcycles and parts vendors at the Pate Transportation Swap Meet in Fort Worth, Texas. Texas Motor Speedway, and check out the massive field of antique cars and motorcycles on display, and visit with the members of the AMCA Cherokee Chapter. More information available at CherokeeAMCA.org. Looking forward to seeing some of our listeners out there. I will be out there with Cherokee folks. We'll have a few bikes out from Carson Classic Motors, and it should be a great time. So if you're coming out, be sure to look us up and look forward to meeting you. If you have a vintage motorcycle-related event that you'd like to publicize, email us at classicchromeradio@gmail.com, and we'd be more than happy to help publicize your event or your product or service. We do a monthly radio show magazine as well as the Road Hogs Motorcycle Magazine, which comes out on the 15th today every month. It's a great magazine filled with columns from all the different radio shows and hosts, and it's a lot of fun to do. So be sure to check it out. You can find out more about that and the Road Hogs by going to theroadhogs.com. And don't forget, this year the Road Hogs is sponsoring a special giveaway. We're going to have a commercial here in a little while from one of our hosts on the Road Hogs Radio Network to find out more information about how you can win and enter. So stay tuned for that. Now, we're still looking for a 1920 Indian board track racer, which was stolen last month from the storage area outside of Gardner, Kansas. Motorcycle serial number is 77R as in Robert 010. Don't forget to contact your local law enforcement authorities with any tips or sightings. And you can also contact Jim Snegus at 785-766-8963 or Jerry Juneman at 913-938-4554 with any information. We're going to be following the updates on this case that goes on the Classic Chrome Facebook page. That's facebook.com/Classic Chrome Radio. And we also publicize it every month in the Road Hogs Motorcycle Magazine. We have an ad in there, so let's see if we can't get this Indian board tracker back to its rightful owner where it deserves to be. All right, folks. So tonight, joining me, I have Mr. Keith Kaiser, the Executive Director of the Antique Motorcycle Club of America, Steve Alexander, the President of the AMCA Smoky Mountain Chapter, and Michael Gehring, the Vice President and Founding Member of the AMCA Smoky Mountain Chapter. One of the most important things about owning an antique motorcycle is a chance to interact with others who have the same passions as you do. And what better way to accomplish that than to join one of the largest old motorcycle clubs in the world, the Antique Motorcycle Club of America. The AMCA provides a nationwide network of old bike enthusiasts who are looking to interact and further the good, clean sport of vintage motorcycles. In addition, the AMCA is also comprised of smaller regional chapters of the club that allow you to meet the people in your area that share your passion. But what if you don't have a chapter near you and still want to have an AMCA affiliation? Tonight, we're going to be talking about just how you can remedy that. So with that, I'd like to welcome Steve Alexander, Michael Gehring, and Keith to the program. Welcome, guys. Glad you could make it tonight.
Thanks, Buck.
Thanks. Great to be here.
All right.
Thanks, Buck.
So, Steve, I'm going to start off with you. What I'd like to do is kind of go around from Steve to Michael and then Keith. And if you would, please tell us a little bit about yourselves and your background in motorcycling. And then we'll kind of get into the formation of the AMCA Smoky Mountain Chapter.
Sure, Buck. Thanks. So, first of all, a real privilege and an honor, you know, to be here on your program, not only to talk about the formation of the chapter, but, you know, to promote our new chapter a little bit. I would like to say, and I apologize, Buck, if I gave you the wrong information on your announcements, but our first general membership meeting is at Barber on the 18th, this coming Saturday. So I just wanted to make sure that everybody knew it was Saturday the 18th, and we're really looking forward, you know, to that event. You know, Buck, I worked in TV early in my career, and I was told that I had a face for radio, but a voice for neither. So it's really a blessing to be on here with you tonight. One thing is, I'd be remiss if I didn't say it, and it's actually a little bit of my background, but today is my mother and father's 54th wedding anniversary, so happy anniversary, Mom and Dad. Love you both, and I hope they're having a great time. Hope they're listening to the program, but Maybe that's both a good time and listening to the program. I grew up in the Midwest in kind of a rural, small farm town, and so everybody kind of had a dirt bike. Who, you know, the cool kids at least did mini bikes, dirt bikes, and kind of grew up and got involved in motorcycles. You know, very, very early, very young, and I kind of took the dirt bike mentality to the street when I was a young adult and paid that price. And I had a pretty bad accident. And so I kind of was out of bikes for about 20 years. And, you know, my dad had a 50th wedding anniversary coming up. We were doing a big party for him and my mother. And I wanted to get him something really special for his anniversary. And I found him an old military Jeep. He was an old Jeep guy and loved Jeeps. And I found him a military Jeep and gave it to him as a surprise gift for his 50th wedding anniversary. And kind of got to thinking about, well, it'd be kind of cool to have, you know, something to go along with that genre or that theme, and you know, kind of a father son thing. And so I started looking for a Indian Scout military. Those are like hen's teeth, and but equally as difficult, I found a WLA. And so you guys probably remember from the Kickstart ride. And so really the hook was set. You know, for my kind of emergence back into the motorcycle world. And, you know, I'd love to say that the vintage and the bike community is great, really helpful. You know, there's forums and internet research that's out there. There's people that interact, you know, on social media, a ton of guys out there that, you know, are really giving to the sport. You know, some great personalities that are out there as well. And what I found is everybody's really willing to help you, right? I think the biggest thing is to kind of be humble, be eager to learn, and you know, everybody is really willing to give back into this. Really, it's an industry, it's a business for some, you know, a sport, a hobby, you know, and to me, really, then the rides are the best networking. And I kind of mentioned the Kickstart that Buzz Cantor puts on every year, and got a chance to go to that, and what I didn't realize at the time was it was kind of a tune-up for the Cannonball, the motorcycle Cannonball that Lonnie Isom Jr. and the folks put on, a great event, and that actually kind of further set the hook for me. And coming out of that, I got really, you know, interested in the Cannonball, followed it. And now I'll be actually participating in the 2016 Cannonball. So really looking forward to that.
That's a very great accomplishment. I'd like to congratulate you on that. Okay, so Steve, if you'll stick with us, and Mike, we're going to take a quick commercial break. When we come back, we'll continue with introductions. We'll go from Mike, then on to Keith, and then we'll start talking about the formation of the Smoky Mountain chapter. So if everybody will stick with us, we'll be right back after this quick commercial break.
Looking for a great place to put your kickstand down? Take a trip through time to scenic Red Boiling Springs, Tennessee, home of the Cyclemost Motorcycle Museum, where in Rust we trust. Be sure to take a long stroll through a large collection of vintage motorcycles and memorabilia representing the two-wheeled history of the United States. After shopping the extensive gift shop, prop your feet up in a rocking chair on the front porch and take in the sights and sounds of history all around you. While visiting, don't forget to check out the world-class Cyclemost Restoration Shop, where history comes to life. Need help getting your classic motorcycle back on the road? Look no further than the experts at Cyclemost Speed Shop, who specialize in all aspects of vintage motorcycles, from engine and transmission builds to complete restorations. With a hard-to-find parts inventory and friendly specialists at your service, Cyclemost can handle your needs. Located at 319 East Main Street, Red Boiling Springs, Tennessee. And also online at www.cyclemost.com. For museum hours and all shop inquiries, please call 615-670-8942. You can also get daily updates from the museum and shop by checking out Cyclemost on Facebook and Instagram.
Hi.
How often do you get the chance to see and hear a rare piece of history as it comes roaring to life? With the tagline of the museum that runs, chances like this occur daily at the All-American Wheels Through Time Transportation Museum. Set at the base of the Blue Ridge Parkway through the Smoky Mountains in Maggie Valley, North Carolina, the grounds of the museum are impeccable and absolutely peaceful. With over 40,000 square feet of antique motorcycles and automobiles from all corners of history presented in perfect running condition, Wheels Through Time offers an enchanting and invigorating step through history for all. As seen on the hit television show, What's in the Barn?, Wheels Through Time offers a breathtaking assortment of mechanical history to be taken in by its visitors. Watch as the hard-working crew fires up one extremely rare motorcycle and car after another and gaze into the vast collections of parts, accessories, and memorabilia presented in display in this living and breathing time capsule. While relaxing on the beautiful museum grounds, be sure to visit the gift shop and purchase a ticket to win a completely restored 1939 Harley-Davidson Knucklehead Bobber from the Wheels Through Time Restoration Shop. You can find out more information about the museum that runs by visiting www.wheelsthroughtime.com or checking out the official Facebook and Instagram pages.
Hey, everybody. Welcome back. It's Classic Chrome on the Road Hogs Radio Network. Glad you could join us. Tonight, we are speaking with Keith Kaiser, Steve Alexander, and Michael Gehring about the AMCA Smoky Mountain Chapter. Now, don't forget, Wheels Through Time is just open for the 2015 season. Check out the museum hours, which are 9 to 5 p.m., Thursday to Monday. If you forget those, you can go to the Wheels Through Time website at wheelsthroughtime.com, and be sure to visit our friends Dale and Trish there at Wheels Through Time. Okay, so back to the show. We've just had spoken with Steve and got a little bit of background on him and the antique motorcycle industry. So now let's talk with Michael. Mike, welcome to the program, and how are you doing tonight, man?
I'm good, Buck, and thanks for having me on. My history in motorcycling is a little different than Steve's, and I kind of joined the motorcycling world a little later in life. As a kid, I was certainly forbidden to even ride motorcycles. I had friends, and I always was quite envious, but that just wasn't going to fly. And certainly had a dad who ruled by an iron fist and belt, so that certainly wasn't an option. So I joined motorcycling at the ripe old age of 41 back in 2003, and immediately fell in love with it. But I didn't really get exposed to antique motorcycles until I met and married my wife. And in 2007, my father-in-law invited us over to the Barber Motorsports Park to the Vintage Festival. And I started seeing some lovely old bikes there, and tens and thousands of people, and just really fell in love with the sport at that particular time. But it still was several years until I got exposed to some real riders and was able to hang out. And that was in 2011 at the inaugural motorcycle Kickstart Classic Ride, which started at in Maggie Valley at the Wheel Through Time Museum, one of your sponsors, and ended up at the Vintage Festival at Barber Motorsports Park. And I absolutely fell in love with the bikes, the riders, the camaraderie, everything. I mean, it gave me the itch. And in that particular year, I rode a modern bike. But through those connections, I knew I absolutely had to get an antique motorcycle, and through help through Buzz Cantor and joining ClassicAmericanMagazine.com, I was able to locate my first antique bike, a 62 Panhead, and ever since I've driven it on every single motorcycle Kickstart Classic every year, sometimes doing a little over 1,000 miles round trip. And I said, I'm not going to have a tow vehicle. I'm going to get it there, hell or high water. And I think every year I've run into some issues, but through the help of all the great riders that you meet in this world, I was able to successfully complete all these rides. I can't say every mile on that last one. We all know I earned a good nickname, Slider Mike. And if you want to hear about that, I think you're going to have to join us at Barber on April 18th. I'll be more than happy to share that particular story. I'm super excited that Steve really took the drive to get this chapter started. I really was sitting in the background. He was looking for people to help out, and you know, I certainly said, "Hey, I'll step up." I'm really excited to be able to share this passion a little more year round than just the local events and the motorcycle kickstart ride. So I'm really excited for this chapter to start.
Well, good deal. Yeah, that's a great story you got there, and I can attest to a few Slider Mike stories, but maybe we'll get into those later on. So with that, Keith, welcome to the show. How are you doing tonight?
Hey, Bob, doing good. Appreciate you having me on again.
Absolutely. Tell us a little bit about yourself and your background in antique motorcycling. I know we had talked about it in a few shows back, but let's kind of refresh our audience.
Well, to start with, I mean, my history of motorcycling goes back to when I was very, very small, but I came from a racing family, so I've been on a motorcycle pretty much since I could walk, but I started racing when I was 11 years old. And so through racing motocross and then flat track, then my brother got into drag racing. So that followed suit, and I got into drag racing with him and then eventually started the drag racing division of the AMA called AMA Pro Star back in the 80s, and then kept that through 2006 when I sold it and went to work for AMA as their senior director of pro racing. So I did that till the most recently, then when I went to work for the Antique Motorcycle Club of America. So that started my first involvement with antique motorcycles, but primarily, you know, I was hired because of my, membership-based, organizational skills in promotion. And that's something that even during the interview process, I said, you know, I'd never heard of the Antique Motorcycle Club. And I think a lot of people that were in the racing industry and still are of the same mindset. So there's a lot of people. I mean, we're very strong, almost 11,000 members now, but there are a lot of people in this country still who have a great love for antique motorcycles who would gladly be a part of this club if only exposed to it. So we're doing that and doing a lot of different marketing campaigns now to try to reach out. And for guys like yourself, Buck, we've talked about that many times, is to reach out to that younger generation. And, of course, as our youth coordinator, that's something that you and I are working very closely on, to try to reach out to that 20s and 30s group. But one of the backbones of the AMCA is its chapters. And the great thing is with the Smoky Mountain chapters, Steve will allude to this later and talk about how this all came about. But thankfully, that is now the newest and 62nd chapter of the AMCA. So just glad to be a part of that and helping it all grow. And thanks to guys like yourself that are helping us spread the word.
Absolutely. More than happy to do it. So what I'm going to do now is I'd like to kind of go with Steve and ask a few questions about the chapter and then get Mike in there as well. What I'd also like to do is we've got some Facebook questions coming in from all over the globe, actually, all related to the AMCA. We've got some questions from Germany, from Key West, actually, and I think Utah. So we'll save like probably the last 15 minutes of the show for questions and answers all related to the AMCA and the Smoky Mountain chapter, if that's okay with you guys. But what I'd like to do is start off and ask, you know, Steve, tell me a little bit about the formation of the Smoky Mountain chapter and how that really came to be.
Yeah, sure, Buck. So really kind of what started the chapter journey, I kind of alluded to how I got re-involved in motorcycles, and just because of the hospitality and the camaraderie that Mike alluded to, I just wanted to become more involved. And, you know, local chapters seemed like a logical step to kind of get more involved, and so I went to the AMCA's webpage, antiquemotorcycles.com, and they have a lot of great resources there, a lot of good information, and specifically I was looking at, you know, the map and the directory for the local chapters and the distribution, and what I found was in my specific geography, there was really not a local chapter within about 4 driving hours of me in any direction. And when I was on the the AMCA webpage. There was actually a strategy survey or questionnaire that was going on. I think Keith was just getting into the role, and he was asking and soliciting input, around, where the members felt like that the AMCA, could improve. And so I actually, took some time and submitted my thoughts, around, some strategy and some thoughts that I saw coming in, as a new member. And really to my surprise, because I've been in a few organizations or clubs, Keith reached out, directly to me, wanted to have some conversations about, my responses. And I was a little bit, shocked in a great way, that the national executive director would give you a phone call back on a response. And so, Keith and I had a couple of conversations about, AMCA participation, growth, because ultimately a club or an organization can't stay stagnant, right? It needs to kind of grow or die, is I think one of the old sayings. And so, as we talked through that, it became kind of apparent that, it would be a good opportunity to kind of, spearhead, I think was the words Keith used, around forming a local chapter. So that's kind of what got it all rolling.
That's a great explanation of how it started. If you would, tell us a little bit about the area of the Smoky Mountain chapter and kind of what it covers. And then, Mike, I'd like to get your take on being a founding member of the chapter and your thoughts on the whole process.
Okay, so as we looked at kind of the area and the footprint, we realized that there was a lot of interest, at least initially, as we kind of went out and canvassed, who might be interested in helping found or form it, and I'll maybe talk a little bit about those steps in a few minutes. But, the interest kind of ranged from the Birmingham area up through kind of Huntsville, Chattanooga, kind of northwest Georgia, outside of Atlanta, and up to, and including kind of the Knoxville area. And so we decided that that would kind of be our kind of initial target, knowing that that's a big footprint, and the logistics to kind of get from one side of that, area to another, still, present problems. So as we've talked through it, we realize as we form and grow the chapter, we actually hope in the longer term that other, local chapters or affiliates or however we, decide to approach that will form. Because I think that participation at the kind of grassroots level, is really going to hinge on that local, that local availability, right? I mean, unless you're trailering these bikes, to be able to kind of do a ride-in or a cruise-in or, those kinds of things takes a pretty big effort. Whereas if you kind of have that localized element, it gives you a little bit more flexibility to do some more spontaneous things around the club and the organization.
Now, Mike, what is your feeling about being a part of this new chapter, being the vice president? What do you see as maybe like the biggest project in your chapter? And kind of your feelings on starting this whole thing. You said you didn't really get involved in antique motorcycles until recently. So, that I'm sure having a local club is a great asset to yourself. And I guess just kind of walk us through the process in your mind of setting up this new chapter.
Well, in setting up this new chapter, I really got to thank both Steve and Keith because they were the real drivers behind this. I know Steve had reached out to a number of us and trying to see if we were interested in starting a new chapter, and I was absolutely on board right from the get-go. Cause, the closest chapter to me, and I'm based out of Atlanta, Georgia, it was 3 hours away in Augusta, and it really was just kind of prohibitive to being involved on any type of a regular basis. So thought of having a local chapter where I can get more involved in something, in a sport, in an activity, in a hobby that I absolutely love was really enticing to me. And I think the footprint is really brilliant for this particular chapter, because it's some of the best riding, I think, in the country. You know, I've ridden from California all the way to the East Coast, and it's just some stunning areas when you think of western North Carolina and the mountains, the Dragon, and you get down through Chattanooga and over to down through Huntsville, and then, of course, ending up at the Barber Motorsports Park. There's some absolutely beautiful riding, and I know there's some great people out there, and being able to have a good reason to get together and share these rides and share these memories and the stories and be able to help each other out, it's really exciting. And I'm really looking forward to being able to contribute in some way and help other people share this passion. And that really, for me, is really being able to share this with other people that really want to enjoy the sport and really learn more about it and make it a family event. And I think having a local chapter really guides itself. And I'm really excited for this chapter. I'm really happy that Steve really kind of reached out, as he kind of described, and filling out that survey and keep just jumping on that. I mean, they're the real drivers behind this, and I'm along for the ride. And, yes, I'm excited about being able to contribute my part. And I'm looking forward to the events that we can create in the future and the rides and more importantly, just getting together with other like-minded folk that want to just enjoy riding classic bikes. It's truly getting on them. I don't care the brand, the age. I mean, it's just getting together with a great group of people.
There you go. I think, Mike, I think that's the perfect representation of what the AMCA is all about, and I'm glad to hear you say it. So if you guys will stick with us, we're going to take another quick break. When we come back, we'll talk about some of the events you have coming up for the chapter.
Hey, everybody, this is Pipes, voice of the Roadhogs and host of the Free Road Report, one of the great radio shows here on the Roadhogs Radio Network. And do I have something to tell you? Starting right now, you can enter to win a free set of Hash Pipes slip-on exhaust system or a pair of hog gaiters. One entry is all it takes to win either one of these great products. You can enter for free every month throughout 2015 at theroadhogs.com. The drawing will be held late December, and winners will be announced in the Roadhogs Motorcycle Magazine and here on the Roadhogs Radio Network. Go to theroadhogs.com and sign up now. You have 12 chances to win and nothing to lose. Find yourself smiling when you see an old motorcycle out on the road? Have you ever wondered about the history of motorcycling and its impact on American culture throughout the decades? Consider becoming a part of the largest vintage motorcycle club in the United States, the Antique Motorcycle Club of America. Since 1954, like-minded vintage enthusiasts have banded together across America to keep the sport of vintage motorcycling alive and kicking. Dedicated to the preservation, restoration, and use of old-time machines, the AMCA supports vintage motorcycles of all types and brands. Throughout the year, the club puts on swap meets, road runs, technical seminars, and all sorts of other great activities for enthusiasts. Members also receive a copy of the Antique Motorcycle, a full-color professional magazine chock-full of helpful information, history, parts, and shops bi-monthly. More information can be found by visiting the club website at www.antiquemotorcycle.org.
Hey, everybody. Welcome back to Classic Chrome on the Roadhog Radio Network. And tonight, we are speaking with Keith Kaiser, Steve Alexander, and Michael Gehring. We're talking about the AMCA and the newly formed Smoky Mountain chapter. So before we left, Michael and I were just talking about a little bit about the challenges of starting a new chapter and the excitement and all the new things that are coming up. Steve, can you tell us a little bit about the events that you have coming up and your first membership meeting and all that?
Yeah, Buck, I would. Maybe just for a second, I'd like to talk a little bit about the effort that kind of went into forming the chapter, if that's okay, maybe just for a couple of minutes. Because there may be, you know, folks out there thinking about, you know, forming a chapter in their area, and it'd be maybe some good insight on what they might be facing into. You know, it's actually not too bad. It's fairly straightforward. There's some great resources on the AMCA website. I'd also be remiss if I didn't say that both Keith Kaiser, executive director and lead of operations, but also Fred Davis, who's the national director of chapters, were just extremely valuable, you know, in helping, you know, me and the group step through the process of forming the chapter. You know, at a high level, it's a two-step process, and Keith will keep me honest here, I'm sure, if I misspeak, but it's really outlined in the bylaws and articles of incorporation that are out there on the antiquemotorcycle.org website. There's a policies and procedures document you can pull down and kind of read through that. And you know, the first step is really petition to form, and you've got to kind of go out and see if there's an interest. Find at least 8 members that are in national members in good standing currently, and then submit basically an application with the intent. The application is then reviewed at the next scheduled board of directors meeting and voted on. And then if affirmed, you kind of go to a step 2, and that's where a little bit of the heavy lifting comes in. You then have to kind of create an articles of incorporation within your state. You got to look at a not-for-profit legal name and do some registration stuff, and then appoint your officers, and then kind of send all that information back to Fred. And then at the following board meeting, that you will then be voted on for approval and chapter certification. We kind of got really, really lucky from a timing perspective. The national board had a teleconference right after we had submitted our application, our petition, and then their actual board meeting was at the Sunshine National meet in Florida earlier this spring. So we kind of got through the process pretty quick, just a luck of the draw and timing. And then one other mention would be that, you know, as you look at forming your chapter in our geography specifically, right, we're kind of at the intersection of 4 states. We had Alabama, Georgia, Tennessee, North Carolina. And so one of the things I had to do was go out and see if there were, you know, any benefits or detriments in where we formed our chapter. You know, some states are a little more restrictive on how you have to set up your directorships and some other things. In some states, the fees are different, and you know, and some of the processes are different and more encumbering. So we kind of looked at that, and you know, it looked like Georgia was the best place for us to incorporate and form the chapter. But I'd say that's just one other element that a prospective chapter forming group would want to look at. You know, if they're obviously in a kind of a landlocked state, so to speak, or within a state where they're only going to be considered within that state, then, you know, they're not going to have to do that evaluation. But we did, because we, you know, we're covering kind of a footprint that crosses a few borders.
Absolutely. And that's some really great insight into other folks wanting to start their own chapters. And we've actually had a couple questions, which we'll get into in probably the next 10 minutes or so, from some Facebook folks out there. You know, and we'll kind of direct those towards Keith and go from there. But what kind of events do you have coming up now that you've got the chapter started, and what's in the future for you guys?
Well, we have the membership, general membership meeting, really our first in-person membership meeting on the 18th at Barber, as you had indicated in the announcement, 1 to 3 p.m. Central Time. So just reiterate, that's 1 to 3 Central Time. Anybody that is attending, you know, our meeting, after the meeting adjourns, then we're going to be able to also take in the museum as a part of that meeting. So it's a great opportunity to see some really world-class, you know, motorcycles and overall race memorabilia that's in that museum. It's a fantastic facility. I've been there once, and once is not enough. As a part of our kind of upcoming meeting, we're going to be working through, you know, director and volunteer elements within our new club, because we are just newly formed, and so we're still, you know, kind of working, you know, through those things. And that's the other thing I'd like to mention is, right, the predominant thing in this AMC organization is it's volunteer, right? I mean, it's on us, the members, to really make this organization what it is, right? And so it really helps when people step up, kind of grab the bull by the horn, so to speak, and really get involved, because because without the involvement, it just becomes this passive thing of, you know, yeah, it's there, but am I really participating? So I would submit and kind of challenge folks to think about, you know, not sitting so much and really looking at, you know, stepping up and getting involved. And then, you know, Buck, we've talked about one of the things we really are looking forward to doing is working on the youth involvement. You know, we're looking at what other chapters are already doing. One of the things we're excited about is we preliminarily reached out to a local technical college that has, you know, a motorcycle technology program. And, you know, we're hoping that we can get involved with them. You know, we can start exposing, you know, folks that are really looking at, you know, the motorcycle industry, you know, as a profession, and thinking about vintage and antique motorcycles as yet just another channel for, you know, for their professional careers and or hobby. So interestingly, as we talked to, you know, one of these professors who's been in the motorcycle industry, and you know, this kind of comes back to, I think, the point Keith made earlier, he really didn't know about the AMCA. And I think that's something as members, right, we've got to be able to change, is to get a broader awareness of this organization and all the things that it can bring and the exposure that it can bring to our, you know, our young folks and carry the sport, the hobby, the industry forward.
That's exactly right. You know, the youth is the future of the antique motorcycle industry as well as the AMCA. So hopefully we'll really get some success out of what you guys are going to do there, and we can spread that throughout the rest of the Antique Motorcycle Club of America. So, guys, what I'd like to do now is we've got some Facebook questions coming in from all over the world. And, Keith, if it's okay with you, I'd like to kind of let you, I guess, head this up and answer a few because they're pretty broad and falls in your neck of the woods. We've got Ken in Key West who is interested about possibly starting a chapter down in the Florida Keys area. He doesn't know how many members may be available or really what the membership number requirement is. Can you kind of walk Ken through a little bit of the process there and give him some advice?
Sure. You know, one of the best things is we've got a tool that we can use and helps anybody that wants to start something like that. So, A, there's two ways. Is, you know, when somebody has a general interest, they can either contact me or contact Fred Davis, which is the director of chapters. And that starts the ball rolling, because in a lot of cases, it's like him, is that he's interested in it but doesn't really have a nucleus of anybody else that he knows of. So one of the things that we've done in the past is we can do an email blast through Constant Contact that goes out to all the AMCA members in any general area. So we can just pick out a zip code range, do an email blast basically in southern Florida, and see what's available. Because, you know, in the state of Florida, we, you know, we do have several chapters there. But the Everglades chapters in South Florida, and also the Gulf Coast chapters in South Florida. But if it's, you know, all the way down in the Keys, so that's, again, a different direction. What we try to do is keep things, you know, at least 100 miles apart, just so that we're not overlapping or trying to cannibalize anybody's chapter. But, you know, we could do an email blast down in the southern tip of Florida from Miami down to the Keys, and see what kind of interest we get, because what most people would be interested in joining a chapter, but a lot of them just don't want to directly get involved with it. So as long as there's somebody that's willing to spearhead it like Steve did, then it's not that hard to start getting other people that go, yeah, you know, I'm definitely interested in that. So that would be the first thing. So if he could just send me an email, I would be glad to help in that effort and try to work towards finding him some other fellow AMCA members in that area that can help him get that going.
There you go. That's some great advice. Now, that kind of leads into the next Facebook question coming out of New York. And this person asks, what's the best way to communicate within the chapters and within the national level? Through emails and through phones? You know, really, what's the best way to keep a constant dialogue going to make sure that things are running correctly, you know, running correctly and smoothly?
You know, one of the best tools that we have for that is actually our forum. You know, as a member, you can log into the forum, and you can talk about a plethora of topics, whether it's specifically about motorcycles or if it's about, you know, what's going on within the club. And if somebody wants to get more specific, it really is great, like what Steve did with me. He responded to an article that I wrote, and he had a list of questions. And I keep every one of those emails. And I address every one of them. And if it's not anything that we can do today, then possibly it's something that we can do tomorrow. But it gives me topics to go back to the board to discuss the needs of the members. So that's the best way. Is I prefer that people would send me emails directly, or they can contact any of the board members. They can get their email addresses straight off of the website. But if they want to, you know, talk to the membership itself and get other people's ideas, the forum is a great tool for that.
Now, Tim in Utah asks, how do you set up the officials within the chapter? Maybe this might be a good one for you and Steve both. What kind of determines the officers in the club, and how does that all work? Can you explain that to folks?
I mean, I can tell you what we did, and then, you know, Keith can tell me what I did wrong. We initially had the founding members that were required to petition. And then we really emulated a lot of the national bylaws. We didn't want to necessarily recreate the wheel or do rework. And I've always heard that plagiarism is the ultimate form of flattery. And so we just looked at, you know, the national bylaws and said there's been a lot of effort there. You know, let's look at those. And what we pulled out of that was there's really four officers that are really required, and typically in your state incorporation it's required as well, and that's your president, vice president, your secretary, treasurer, right? So we went with the founding members, right? We did nominations and voting through the founding members and appointed directors. Now our real next step is to elect, you know, permanently, per our bylaws, we'll elect our officers, and I think we set that up for a three-year term. And then there will be also be some directors and some committees as we start to grow, where we'll want to get a better focus on some activities. So it really, in my perspective and opinion, how we approached it, we kind of wanted to start with the basics that were required, and know then we have the flexibility to kind of expand as we grow. But we didn't want to start really big with a bunch of positions and then realize we had, you know, almost as many positions as we had members.
Now, Keith, what's your take on that?
There's no right or wrong way to do it. But like Steve said, I mean, you want to work with the people who are, you know, willing to step up and work, because you do want officers that are going to get involved. And it takes a lot of work, especially when you start planning. I mean, some of these chapters, they've got something going on at least on a monthly basis, whether it's a ride or whether they're doing displays at different motorcycle shows. So you've got to have that volunteer base, as opposed to putting it just on, you know, a couple of the officers at the top of the club or the top of the chapter. So you've got to reach out and find those. And, you know, basically when this started up, Steve is the one that really spearheaded the effort. So it was real quick in all the emails, because we just started piling on with different people that wanted to be involved, and we're shooting emails back and forth. So I immediately just nominated that Steve would be the president, since he's the guy that started this off, because we have to start somewhere. And everybody unanimously jumped in on that. And this is just phone call meetings that we're having to start with, an email. But that's what leads to this first meeting that we're having this Saturday. Then you can officially start electing officers past that. You know, we do have our first four officers. And, you know, just to give credit to everybody on that, again, Steve Alexander's the president. Mike is the vice president. Jake Seegers is the treasurer. And Chris Price is the secretary. So then we'll move forward Saturday to actually reach out and try to elect some different directors that can help out as well, because in most strong chapters you'll have, you know, either 3 to 6 or even more directors that are your worker bees that'll get in there and help direct things. And again, we're the very newest chapter, and we're going to be looking out to other chapters to mimic some of the things that they do because, you know, we're not experienced in putting on our own road runs or different events, so we're going to learn that from the guys around us. And we have the support of all the other chapters, because before this ever went any further than the first step, then one of the things that I do is a courtesy call. I call every individual chapter that's anywhere with outside the boundaries of our footprint, just to let them know that there's somebody interested in starting another chapter, because like Steve said from the very beginning, we don't want to cannibalize anybody's chapters. So we just want to put it out there that, hey, if you're looking for something that's closer, then you can get involved. And a ton of people like yourself belong to a bunch of different chapters. So, you know, it's in whoever you want to have your camaraderie with, and you want to go participate, so it doesn't matter how far you go. But the nice thing about what we've got going, we agreed from the very beginning that, okay, this is going to be based up in northern Georgia, but there are people that similarly in Chattanooga, in Birmingham, and in Huntsville that also are in that same predicament, that it's far away to go to any kind of chapter meetings and stay involved. So we have this agreement that we'll do off splinter chapters or affiliates, however, you know, Steve directs that, that hopefully we can start a chapter in Birmingham, we can start a chapter in Huntsville, and then, you know, in a way that I see that is we kind of go out and form our own coalition like other multiple chapters do that have national events. One thing that, as far as the events that we've got going on, you know, to out there in the future is, you know, we're looking to work with one of our founding members, Kurt Coomer of the Lynchburg Choppers up in Lynchburg, Tennessee. And so we tentatively already through Rick Nahara, our national event director, is we tentatively have a date set for 2017 to have a national road run sponsored through the Smoky Mountain chapter. So, but at least we're on the list to get that done. We applied for that for 2016, but there were six different chapters that applied, and we being the low man on the totem pole, missed out on that, but we'll be higher up on the rankings when it comes for 2017. So we feel pretty comfortable that we'll get that.
Absolutely. Yeah, exciting times are ahead for the Smoky Mountain chapter. We've got time for two more questions that have come in. We've got Sandy in Arizona, and we've got Cutter in Germany, actually, who's asking questions. So we'll do those two questions. We'll kind of wrap it up for the evening. But Sandy in Arizona asks that she kind of gets the vibe that the AMCA might be somewhat more of an all-male club. Is there any chapters within the network that are all female, or are there any plans for anything like that?
Currently, to the best of my knowledge, there is not one that's all female. But the thing that we are currently working on through the directive of our president, Richard Spagnoli, is that he wants us to start reaching out and trying to form a women's affiliate within the club. How exactly we're going to piece that together, I don't know. I would greatly appreciate any input on that. But we have a lot of members that are, you know, single women or, you know, widows, what have you, that they're members of the chapter, they ride. And so we want to, you know, not necessarily, I mean, we're certainly not opposed to starting women-only chapters. That would be great. But we want to do this nationally as well, that we can do something. You know, there's the Motor Maids. We have lots of members that are part of the Motor Maids, but we want to give specific focus to women in antique motorcycling. So we're at the beginning stages of that, and if Sandy would contact me, that would be wonderful. Anybody can contact me directly at amcaexecutivedirector@gmail.com. That's amcaexecutivedirector@gmail.com, and I'd be stoked to get any kind of information to help that. And again, if Sandy wants to reach out to me, we can certainly get something like that going.
And I'd just like to tag on one comment too, Buck. As we kind of looked at, you know, how we wanted to set up our membership and dues, we consciously said that, you know, our membership's going to be by household. And specifically, we wanted, you know, the household to be, you know, husbands, wives, you know, children, dependents in the household, so that it's a family organization. So, you know, we specifically and consciously thought about that as we thought about how to structure a membership in our chapter. I know that, you know, not everyone's structured that way, but we felt like that that would be, you know, conducive to get more of a family atmosphere, youth, right, spouses, male and female, interested in working and participating in the club.
So the last question I have for you guys actually comes out of Germany, because we are a worldwide show. We get a lot of listeners, and I'd like to subsequently thank all of our listeners all around the world, including Canada. We've got a lot of listeners up north, so thank you all for tuning in. But the question that comes from Germany, and I'm pretty sure, Keith, you have a great answer for this. Cutter wants to know, how can they, in Europe, how can they reach out to other antique motorcycle enthusiasts within the AMCA?
As before, there's different ways, and through the forum, it is the best way to do that. Germany, you know, we have a united front out in Europe with the European chapter. And, of course, you know, within that, people can communicate, but mostly through the forum is the best way to do that if they're trying to communicate with each other. But Steve Slocum of the European chapter would be happy to help, you know, get information out as well. I could do email blast that way, but really the forum is the best way for these guys to communicate with each other. They can just go in as a member and start a text string, any discussion that they want to have.
Now, the last question I got, and we're going to kind of wrap up for the evening, but are there any plans to branch out within Europe or the U.S. with any other chapters in the works, kind of like the Smoky Mountain chapter?
Well, sure. I mean, we need – you could look at our map. If you go to our website, theantiquemotorcycle.org, and you go to the chapter information and look at that chapter map, it's real easy to see where the holes are. You know, we outside of now, we've got Smoky Mountain that's covering Alabama, and that's why the guys at Barber, Jeff Ray, when he heard of that, he immediately wanted involved, and the Barber Motorsports Museum is part of our chapter. And so that fills that void. But if you look at the map, we have nothing in Louisiana. We have nothing in Mississippi, New Mexico. So there, and even though you might have one or two or multiple chapters in areas, it doesn't mean that these people can actively participate because of the distance. That's why California has five chapters. So it's able to grow any which direction. And as executive director, one of my charges in the very beginning was to expand chapters, because when you expand chapters, then you expand the membership. And we need that camaraderie. We need people to be able to reach out on a local basis. We just got a new charter from one up in Michigan that's going to be voted on this weekend as their first step. But certainly I'm reaching out to other ones around the country. We're trying to work on another one in California right now, one out in Nevada. So it's up to the people and the needs of the members as to where we go. So I'm constantly reaching out, as is Fred Davis, trying to expand the chapter base. But certainly if anybody has an interest in that, please contact me or Fred Davis. Our information is all available on the website, and we'll be glad to do what we can to get that started.
Well, Keith, I want to thank you for your time. You're doing a great job as the executive director. I know we've got some great things up in the works, so we look forward
to it.
We'll be having you back on the show. Steve and Mike, I want to congratulate you both on, you know, starting a new chapter. It's going to be a great road for you. I'm excited to see what comes out of the Smoky Mountain chapter, and if there's anything I can do on the program to help, you'd be more than happy. Now, Steve, if you can, can you tell our audience where to go to find out more information about the Smoky Mountain chapter and where to join?
Yeah, Buck, thanks, and thanks for having us. So right now we're just on Facebook, so Smoky Mountain Chapter AMCA, so you can find us on Facebook. We also have a chapter email, SmokyMountainAMCA@gmail.com. They can drop me an email there, or they can reach out to us on the Facebook page.
All right, guys. Well, thanks again for being on the show. I had a lot of fun with you. We'll be looking forward to another show in the future and hearing about the Smoky Mountain chapter. with that, folks, it's going to do it for us tonight. Tonight's programming was brought to you in part by the Antique Motorcycle Club of America, Cycle Mo's Motorcycle Museum, Wheels Through Time, Retro Cycle, Carson Classic Motors, Georgia Motorcycle History, the Rocky Mountain Motorcycle Museum, and the Race of the Century by Motorcycle Cannonball. All right, folks, until next week, we'll see you on the wave.